Now, I want to continue this morning talking to you about Peter. And we finished 1 Peter last week. Amen. Praise the Lord. Well done. Turn to the person next to you and say, well done. You've done it. We're through 1 Peter. And now we're coming into 2 Peter. I wanted to go on. And, you know, I'm praying around. And maybe after Peter, we will go to the book of Revelation. Maybe, yeah. Well, maybe we'll go to Revelation. I'll just pray and ask the Lord, because I think it is timely to go to the book of Revelation of what is happening in the world. And have you noticed what I said? It is the revelation, not revelations. It's one revelation. Amen. But I'm not going to talk about that now, maybe in a couple of weeks, because I want to continue what Peter is writing to these people. And what I said last time is 1 Peter is actually milk. You know, if you go through 1 Peter and you read there, he's actually addressing our Christian life, and he's going on about persecution that's coming, and he's giving us instruction how to live our lives. And then we come to the meat now. We come to 2 Peter. If 1 Peter was talking about the dangers, and, you know, from outside, the persecution, people will come and they will beat you up for what you believe in. And there, if those times come, you can always turn to the letter of Peter and find courage there and encouragement. And you can go there and God will speak to you and He will strengthen your body and He will strengthen you. Now, 2 Peter talks from the danger within the church. The danger that's sitting in the church. And who knows that there's danger in churches? Who knows that there are wolves in sheep clothing? Who knows that there are false teachers and false prophets and all of these. And this is what 2 Peter is going to go into. And when I started to pray about it and say, Lord, where do I go? Do I go straight into Revelation? Do I go to Ephesians? Do I go to an Old Testament book? And I put it all out before the Lord. I believe the Lord showed me that we need to talk about the danger within the church. Because I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, that there is a spirit of the world that enter into some churches. And it's now a social gospel rather than the true gospel. It is a gospel which is trickling the ears rather than address the issues. And this is why it is so encouraging to see our men in this church turning up when we handle the tough questions of life. And I'll tell you, that's a man. That's a man who comes and say, I need to hear it as it is. A coward is somebody who runs away. He says, I don't want to hear that. But it is a man who stands up and say, I'm lost, I'm a sinner, I need Christ. And secondly, I need to change to come into His image. And I'm also so encouraged in this church that our sisters has dusted off a lot of things, isn't it? You remember the dusting sermon? And the sisters are addressing things which is really, really heavyweight. I mean, and you are turning up. This is so good. You have to work on it. And you're going to hear a lot about working on your faith today. And this is what it is so encouraging. And then the young people come together. And I'm telling you what, Ian is not holding back. You know, it's addressing the Word of God and preaching the Word of God. And the young people are turning up. So that encourages me. That in a world where you look at where a lot of people are falling by the wayside, people want to stand up and they want to hear the truth and they want to walk in the truth. Is that you this morning? As a man, as a woman, and as a young person, I want to walk in the truth. Doesn't matter what the world say. We've had enough of the world over the last 40 years. And I'm telling you, if you haven't seen the signs in the world yet, it is going to vanity. It's going to destruction. And there's only one path that will bring you to true life, and that is the gospel way. Amen? And that is so encouraging to see that, and to see that you turn up. And we preach it as it is. And when Brother Oral comes up here and he preaches the gospel, It's all about the gospel. And that's the good news. And sometimes it's hard. And some people I say, wow, that's a very hard word that's going out. And some people will say, don't preach that in the churches because the people won't come. People don't want to hear this stuff, but you are coming. And that is so good. And it's so wonderful. And then when Brother Murray comes up here, he goes to the Word. It's no stories. It just opens up the Word. And in a well-researched study of the Scriptures brings out the gold. And all of this is for you and for me to do one thing. And that is to grow in our faith. We have to grow in our faith. Now, I've done a little bit of the intro there already, and I've said a few of these things already. But Peter is now warning people about false teachers in this letter. And we're not going to get to the false teachers today. But he's warning about false teachers who teach dangerous doctrines. Doctrine is a code of belief. And, you know, I believe that somebody said to me, one of the brothers said to me yesterday, that when he was saved, he was reading the Bible and going to commentaries. Commentaries is nothing wrong with. But I believe the church has become lazy. People in the church has become lazy. We will go and hear what the pastor say about this rather than study it for ourselves. If I don't understand it, I will go and see what a commentator say about this before I study it for myself. You see, there comes a point where you have to put all the stuff away and go to the Word and read the Word and start read the Word and start read the Word and keep on reading the Word until the Holy Spirit, who's your teacher, will teach you. And Scripture always backs Scripture. The best commentary you can have on the Bible is the Bible. And this is so powerful. So, and then once you start learning these things, you will quickly see the dangerous doctrines that's going around. He starts by talking about their personal lives before he goes into these false teachers. He says, I want you to understand something. You need to understand and be healthy before we're going to look at the fake. That is what he says. So when you work, I understand they don't have bank tellers anymore. But back in the day, when you hand your cash over the counter, they count it so quickly. But they apparently train these people how the good notes are so that they feel a fake quickly. So this is where Peter starts with this letter. He's talking about personal lives. And this needs to be a pursuit of moral excellence, of knowledge, of self-control, perseverance in the child of God. I look around some people and toughness come upon their lives and they quickly to say, I'm losing my faith. Have you heard that? Circumstances coming into their lives and it's so quickly to say, I lose my faith. God, where are you when I need you? Well, he's there. But if your faith has grown, you will understand how God works. And it's perseverance, godliness. He's going to talk about that. Brotherly kindness, selfless love. And he compared that against the false teachers. With these false teachers who are sensual, they're arrogant, greedy, and covetous. Isn't it right? Have you seen some of these false teachers, how they can say to you, you give me a seed of $1,000, and God will turn it into $10,000. Have you heard that before? And you know what? People blatantly do that. And I go, what's wrong with you? And you know what is wrong? They don't read their Bibles. They don't study their Word. And you know, if they catch them out by that, then it's not those people, it's you. You must study and grow in the faith. And that's what today's all going to be about. I want to talk to you about this. I want to talk about building blocks of faith. We need to grow in faith. We need to grow in the fullness of Christ, in that grow. We need to work upon these things, and this is what Peter is going to talk about. Now, let me read, and then I'm going to come back and unpack it for you. 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 1, Simon Peter, a bondservant of the apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us by the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. Grace and peace, Brother Ian, grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and Jesus our Lord. As his divine power has given to him all, to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of him who called us by glory and virtue, by which have been given to us, exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these, you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. There is a pathway in those scriptures that will allow you to escape the corruption of the world. Can you see it? One long sentence. One long sentence. From there right down to there. One long sentence. And within this sentence, there's a pathway for you and for me to escape the corruption that the world brings through lust. Do you know what's the definition for lust? Lust is satisfying self at the expense of others. Now let me continue. Verse 5, but also, what also, Peter? But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours, listen now, if these things, for if the things are yours and abound, it means become more and abound, you will be neither barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. For he who lacks these things is short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that he has cleansed from his old sin. You know, I can close the Bible now, go and eat, have a nice meal with you this afternoon, get in my car and go home, and I'd be so grateful for the Word of God has been spoken in public. The Holy Spirit should be so within you now that you already has got a message just by me reading that. Is the Holy Spirit truly your teacher? Are you already convicted by me just reading that? I say it to the brothers, when you preach behind the pulpit, hide behind the cross. Let the Word of God do the work. And I believe His Word has gone out today and will not return void, but it will accomplish what it's been purposed for. Now, I just want to break it open for you because I found a few nuggets, and then we're going to talk about this pathway to fullness and what is your role in that. First of all, we look at that first verse. Simon Peter, a bondservant of the apostle Jesus Christ. We know this. I'm not going to say it over again, but he is a bondservant. That means he's somebody who came up. It's not under duress. He comes and he gives himself over to the master. He's not expecting any payment, no favors, nothing. That's what a servant is. And then by way, God is calling each one in this place to be his servant. Not to have rights. No, we come and we serve him out of our own free will. We come to him. We come to him. And then he says, an apostle of Jesus Christ. He tells them his title, an apostle. And I can tell you about apostle. I believe that there is no apostles today. Different sermon. I won't waste time on it for now. To those. Now I want to come to this now. He says, to those who have obtained like precious faith with us the righteousness of our God and Savior Jesus Christ. Peter is talking to people who have received the same precious faith as what the apostles had. They've received the faith from God. And he now talks to the people. In fact, in the first letter, he most probably wrote more to the Jewish side of the church than the Gentiles. But now he groups them all together and he now calls them those people. And I want to be the those people this morning. Because the those people have received something from God, and it's called precious faith. He says, I'm talking to you who've obtained like precious faith. Like us, we've obtained this precious faith. The word there, obtained, comes from a Greek word, langchano, which means to get something, not because you've earned it, but rather received as a result of God's grace. Wouldn't you just thank the Lord this morning for His grace? You haven't worked for that. It's not because of how good you are. And I put a reference in there of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. Who knows what that verse says? He says, for by grace you have been saved through faith. Say it again. Not of yourself. It's a gift of God. Now, somebody asked me about this. They say, this faith that you receive, where, whose faith is it? Brothers and sisters, you can't believe in God without faith. Faith is the foundation. Now, in that particular verse, he talks about grace. He says, we have been saved by grace. Now, I want to give you an example. Now, if faith is like a hose pipe, this is like a hose pipe which goes into your house. The water needs to come into your house. But it's not the hose pipe that's going to satisfy your thirst, is it? What's satisfying your thirst? The water. Grace is that water. God gives you grace, and grace satisfies you. Grace gives you peace, but it comes through faith. Without faith, you will not get grace. Now, this is the amazing thing, because a lot of people say, but it's my faith that I put forward. No, it's faith that God first of all give you, and then the faith grows through the word. I'll show it to you in a minute. This is a critical thing to understand. Because if you understand this, then you realize that when I get saved, I can't just come and sit in church and she'll be all right, mate. And the pastor needs to put me in the wheelbarrow and wheel me into heaven. No, no, it's your responsibility to grow in the faith. Faith comes from God as much as grace comes from God. So first of all, He plants within you through the Holy Spirit and through a calling that calls you closer to the fire. Through, and then what happens? Once you receive this faith, grace comes in. And grace is salvation that comes into your life. And we understand that we've obtained this. Now, he says here, faith wasn't given to them because of anything that they did, but it was through the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Righteousness is to live a life acceptable to God. Jesus Christ lived a life acceptable to God the Father when He was here. And it is because of His righteousness that we receive that grace. Isn't it beautiful? You are sitting here this morning, and if you are those people, then you have obtained that same faith that Peter was walking around with, that Paul was walking around with. You've received the same faith, and it's called precious faith. Brothers and sisters, faith is the foundation that it will be built on. Now let's have a look. In verse 2, we come to these words, grace and peace be multiplied to you. Grace, there is the word charis. It's the word charis. It means getting something that we did not deserve. We received salvation. We didn't deserve that. And peace is a beautiful word because it comes from the word irene, which means tranquility and rest. Now, I want to show you this because it is so beautiful when Ian was standing here and he was quoting out of all of those passages that you will always find that grace comes before peace. You cannot have peace if you haven't got grace. People are seeking for peace in the world. They want peace. People want peace. I'm telling you now, there are people who are sitting around and they can't sleep at night. They roll from one side to another. Their conscience is convicting them every single day. There's no peace. If you want peace, you need to come to grace. And it's not work that you do. You can't go and work and deserve it. This is by the righteousness of Christ. He says it already. You know, I don't want to repeat it and go on for too long, but he says, we receive this by, everybody say by, the righteousness of yourself. There's no one righteous, not one. We were all born sinners, but then we came to saving grace and we received His grace. And now we see that that gives us tranquility and rest. It gives us the peace, and grace comes before peace, and peace follows grace. Peace is the reward of grace. But here is the thing, and I want to really get into this because I believe there's a little bit of a nugget here. Both will increase the more you know Jesus. You see, we need to abound. We need to increase. We need to grow. And here he says it. He says, grace and peace be. Everybody say multiplied. If he says multiplied, then it can multiply. That's why he uses the word. He says it must multiply to you in the... So what is going to multiply grace? What is going to multiply peace? What is it? The knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. And I want to talk to you about that. You see, in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, he also says, but grow in the grace at the end of this letter, and we're going to finish with that maybe in 2 weeks or 3 weeks' time. 2 Peter chapter 3, 18, he says, but grow. Everybody say grow. What does grow mean? Multiply. Isn't the Bible good? This is why I say the Bible, interpret the Bible. Multiplication comes from growing. Growing comes from multiplication. But grow in the grace. There's grace. Grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To Him be the glory forever and ever. The question is, how do you grow, isn't it? How do you grow? Now let's have a look. I want to show you something here. Again, we come back to this verse. And he talks here about the knowledge. And I want to talk to you about knowledge, and I want to talk to you about this here, called us by glory. First of all, when he talks about knowledge, from verse 1 to verse 8, he uses five times the word knowledge there. Have you noticed? In chapter 2, 1 verse 2, he says, multiply to you by the knowledge. The Greek word there for knowledge is the word epignosis. Epignosis. And I do this specifically because in the English we've only got one word, and that's the word knowledge. And knowledge has got a few meanings in the English language, but I have to explain that to you before you understand it. Whereas where the Greek is so much more forward, when you see in the Greek what it means, you understand what he says. And this is so beautiful. Because when Peter writes down there in verse 2, he says, grace and peace multiply to you in the knowledge, epignosis, of God and of Jesus our Lord. And then he goes on and he says in the same voice, he says, through the knowledge, the epignosis of Him who called us by glory and virtue. Now that is knowledge. And he says to us that that knowledge needs to multiply, the epignosis. But then we see in verse 5, fascinating. But also for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue and virtue knowledge. Now he uses the word gnosis. You see that? And he says to gnosis, self-control. And then he continues on. And then in verse 8, he jumps back to this word. He says, for these things are yours and abound. You see the word abound is tied to the word epignosis. Can you see that? Multiplication is tied to the word epignosis, and he says, these things are yours and abound. You will be neither barren nor fruitful to the epignosis of our Lord Jesus Christ. So what is Peter on about? Or are you saying this morning, Pastor, you are really getting so technical now. Amen. Do you love the technicality of the Word of God? Do you? Now let me try to make it fun for you, okay? I'm not a Greek scholar. I mean, Brother Murray is very more well-versed in Greek than me. But I find this fascinating because if you just read the Word of God observantly, you won't get these little things that Peter is talking about. What is he talking about? Let's see the words. Epignosis means a practical experience, experiential knowledge of God. It means more than just head knowledge. There's a lot of people who walk around and they've got a lot of head knowledge. They can quote scriptures like this, like a parrot. A parrot can do it as well. You give me a parrot and I teach him, I say a scripture verse to him every single day for a month, and after a month he says the scripture verse back to you. You walk into my house and you say, whoa, that parrot has got salvation. He's a Christian bird. For God so loved the world. Whoa, you send him out to go and preach. But he's only a parrot. Isn't it right? Unfortunately, there are some people who call themselves Christian who's just learned there. This is what Peter is getting to. I love this. The second word there, gnosis, means informal knowledge. Informal knowledge, it means to understand something. It means to study about something, to read about something. Let me give you an example. I'm driving there on a beautiful golf course and I see this rain and I see this beautiful. It stretches right through the sky. It's a rainbow, a beautiful rainbow. And I look and I go back into my mind. Where have I seen something like this? No, this is the most beautiful one I've seen. I jump onto the phone. There's no FaceTime here, okay? Don't call me out. I jump on the phone and I go, Leonie, you need to see this rainbow. And she goes, I've never seen a rainbow in my life. Explain it to me. How do you explain a rainbow? A rainbow. I say, hold on. I jump on my phone and I go into one of the encyclopedias on my phone and it says, this is how a rainbow is formed. All of these rays goes into the sky. It hits these drops and then it shortens some of the rays and it comes down and it forms all of those through and that forms a rainbow. And I say, and I read it to her, I say, this is how a rainbow is formed. All of these short waves and long waves and the sun comes through and it divides the light rays and that's formed. Can she see what I see? But is that correct, how a rainbow is formed? Yes, that's the difference. That's the difference that Peter is talking about here. He says there are some of you who study, who read, and they come to the technical points about it, and they want to reason God out in their minds. They want to say, God, but this is how you ought to work. It reads it, and they read books and books and books and lectures about God, but they never ever in their life has met God. Is that you this morning? You see, there's people who are coming into churches and they sit and they've listened to over 10,000, 20,000 sermons in their lives, but they haven't moved a bit in growing in grace and faith. This is what he's talking about. This is where he's going now. You cannot reason God out in your mind. But there's a place for both. Now let's, with this understanding, see what he says. He says now, peace, all of these multiply in the knowledge, in the experimental knowledge of God and of Jesus. You have to experience God. How do you experience God? You need to cry out to Him and say, Lord, I want to experience it. This is when God starts to work through your life and through obedience you start to do things and you see the hand of God moving in your life. That's experiencing God. That's a different know than just knowing God. You get my drift? That's a different epignosis than gnosis. You have to have an experience with God. Here is Paul. He's on the road of Damascus, Saul of Tarsus, he's there. He understands every single prophecy in the Old Testament. He studied the prophets. He sat under Gamaliel. He knows it by front to end. He knows about a Messiah who needs to come. He's heard about this Messiah. But then a light brighter than the sun shone through and then he met him face to face. Brothers and sisters, you and I need to meet Christ face to face. And if you come to him, he will reveal himself to you. This is what Peter is talking about. He says, this is what's going on here. He says, we need to have this kind of knowledge of God and of Jesus the Lord. The divine power, which I will talk in a minute about, which comes through that kind of knowledge of Him who called us into these things. But there is a place for this kind of book knowledge or head knowledge. There is a place for that. Let me remind you what Job said in Job 42. And by the way, if you've got your Bible, I want to show you something beautiful. Open up in Job 42. If you go to Job 42, it's the last chapter in Job, isn't it? Job for 42 chapters. Count them off. Chapter 1, chapter 2, chapter 3, chapter 4, chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7. It's all calamity for Job, isn't it? Does that feel like your life? Come on, be honest with me this morning. Oh Lord, it's just trouble upon trouble upon trouble upon trouble. Some people say, I don't even know why I was born. It is just trouble, Lord. And one after the other, the chapters fly over. You read through those chapters one by one by one, and you come all this way, and people want to give all of these solutions, and they talk about gnosis, knowing God, and all of these things. People who think they know about this, but there's no experience with God. Look at this now, at the very last chapter. Job comes and God starts asking him a few questions and the penny dropped for him and he says these words. He says, I have heard of you by the hearing of the ear. How many people are sitting in churches and just hearing of him? But, everybody say but. Now my eye sees you. My eye sees you now. You're sitting here this morning, you say, preacher, I've been a Christian for 10 years. I don't see it like you see it. You get so excited about it. Why can't I get excited about it? Maybe you need to start seeing him. Maybe you need to start, stop hearing just about him. And for yourself, sit down and read. Listen, somebody said about this 2 Peter. He said when he preached, a preacher, he said he preached in 2 Peter and he went to Tori. He went to Tori, that preacher. He says, it's so empty for me. And you know what Tori said to him? He said, read that verse, that letter 25 times a day and come to me in a month. I think it's by the 15th day he was bowling his hour's eye just by that one letter because he saw Jesus in that letter. But we are so lazy these days because we've got all of these things. We've got our phones. The Bible is on your phone. We can quickly flick to a verse. We can quickly read a commentary. We can just come to that pastor and, you know, the brothers in the church needs to uplift us and build our faith. No, no, no. If you want to see him for who he is, you need to put in the work to go to him. He will reveal him. Listen to me. He will reveal himself to you if you diligently seek him. Not just by observantly reading it. Job comes here, he says, but now my eye sees you, therefore I abhor myself. He goes, I abhor myself because now I see you myself through your eyes and I repent in dust and ashes. Now, this is why I wanted you to turn to the last chapter, okay? He says this. This is a man, Job, who prayed for his children in chapter 1. You remember that? This is a man, when the world looked at him, they would have said, what a great Christian. Yes? Come on, be with me here. This man prayed for his children every single day. Then calamity hits him, chapter after chapter after chapter. But I want to suggest to you, he never had the experience, knowledge of God at that point in time. He was a Christian all his life, but he never came to this point until now. And he says, now I see you and see what God does for him. My brother is so right. God is not an angry God. God is there for you. Now, I'm not going to start to sound like, what is this Austin guy? You know, I'm not going to say you are loaded and packed. No, no. There's a difference here. But God is for you, my brother, my sister. Listen to this. Look at verse 10. Look at I haven't got it up there. It just dawned upon me after I've done this. Look at this now. Look at verse 10. He says, and the Lord restored Job's losses when he prayed for his friends. Indeed, the Lord gave Job twice as much as he had before. This is not prosperity gospel, by the way. Can you see? Now, this is why when I read here and I come to the New Testament and I read and you go, Pastor, why are you going down into these little words? This excites me, Max. This makes me wake up and go, Lord, you thought this out way before my little brain could anticipate what's going on. Listen to me. This is the IV. You know what an IV is? In my bloodstream, sister. This is the IV in my bloodstream. Because now, in my little understanding of God, I've got a little bit more understanding. Just by those two words, gnosis and epignosis, eh? Who would have thought? My question to you this morning is, how do you know him? How do you know him? Okay, let me carry on because here comes another one. This is beautiful, okay? Who's got a King James Version Bible here? Or I believe you do. Can you read this verse for me in the King James? It is this one here, 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 3. I want to show you how beautiful it is to study the Word of God. Listen to me this morning. The time for just reading your Bible is gone. You must now study the Word of God, yeah? You must study it. Look at this now. He says, as the divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and to godliness through the knowledge of him who calls us by. Everybody say by. Glory and virtue. Or all? Yep.
According as his divine power has given unto us all things that pertain unto life and godliness, to the knowledge of him that has called us to glory and virtue.
Yeah, look at that. Light just killed on me once we get to the punchline. Here we go. Who was that? We turned off the power. Yesterday when the men was around, we said 10 push-ups. We turned out the power. Look at this now here. This is beautiful. He says, this is the New King James Version. He says, who called us by, everybody say by, glory and virtue. Here he says, who called us to glory and virtue. Isn't that right? Now, some people say, you see, that's why I say to you people, the Bible contradicts itself. There's two translations. Let me just remind you, it is translations. Okay? English is a translation. It's not the true writings. It comes in Greek, Aramaic, and in Hebrew. Yes? Yeah? So, if this happens, what do? You go to the Greek. You go to the Greek. And now we need to unpack it, and I've done it for you so that you don't have to do it. Have a look at this now. This is so beautiful. The word there that sits in those two places is the word Ida or Dia. Am I saying it right, Brother Murray? Dia, Dia. Dia, that's it. And that means his own, his own. And that's so interesting for me when I get into this and I go, wow, Lord, this is a blessing to me, and I pray it's a blessing to you. For us to understand this, by the first one, if you read that in there, it should say, the knowledge of him who called us his own glory and virtue. Who called us his own glory and virtue. Now, why did the translators go to this? Now, in the New King James Version, if you read the word by, it means that God is calling us by and through his own glory and virtue. It's nothing that you and I did. It's his glory and his virtue. It means that it's an instrument through which he calls us. The emphasis in the New King James Version is on God's character and on the basis of our calling. Can you see that? And this is so good for me. I say, Lord, thus bless me. Because it means it's not works that I've done, but you have called me through your glory and through your virtue. You've called me. And I thank the Lord because his glory and his virtue is uncorrupted. Uncorrupted. So I can live with the New King James Version. I can say, Lord, because my glory and my virtue certainly is corrupted until you saved me. Yes? But still we are living in a body of sin. So I'm rather going to trust your glory and your virtue. Do you understand the New King James? But let's now look at the King James, if you want to look at that. The King James, he uses the word to, which says God calls us with the purpose of leading us into his glory and virtue. It emphasizes the goal and the destination of our calling. Is that correct? Both are correct. Both are correct. I can live with both translations. You know, brothers and sisters, when he saved you, he wants you to come into his glory and into his virtue. And now I can back it up with the rest of those verses. And because now we get into this, and we're going to finish with this today. We're going to finish with this because this talks about fullness. How many times have you read over this verse? You know what will happen? We read quickly over these things. We read quickly, don't we? He says it there. He says, but now that we know both of these translations push us towards this word, his own. Now he says, but also for this very reason. For the reason that you and I know that we are saved by faith through grace through faith. For this very reason, give all diligence to add to your faith. And we're going to unpack these things here. But first of all, I want to talk to you about this word, all diligence. All diligence. I said it so many times in this church. I said there are people sitting in churches and they are fat sheep. They just want to sit and receive word and not work on their salvation. Who knows that you need to work on your salvation? You must work on your salvation. You need to work out your own salvation. Not for saving grace, but after that. You need to work on your faith. And he says it right there. The word there for diligence is a strong word. Let's see if it jumped up. It means to be very serious and committed about something. This requires your best efforts and your persistence. Now, what is Peter talking about? He's looking at these Christians and he says there's something that you need to do. You must give it everything you've got, every single thing. Spiritual growth doesn't just happen by accident. Who knows that? Oh, I'm just going to turn up at church and then it's going to happen. I'm going to grow. Look, I'm here. I'm growing. But what happens when difficult time comes? Then your faith is shaken. No, no, it just doesn't happen. It requires dedication and it requires active participation. Active participation. So it all starts with, and I'm sorry for those at the back here, you can get it later on. It starts with faith. He says there, and with diligent add, everybody say add, to your faith. You see, faith is the foundation on which you build. First of all, God gave you that faith, and now you grow that faith. There are three building blocks, and there's more if you want to go and search them, but for me personally, there's three building blocks for you to build your faith. First of all, it is the Word of God. You must study the Word of God. Romans chapter 10, verse 17 says, for faith cometh by?
Hearing.
And hearing by?
The
Word of God, the preaching of the Word of God. So if you want to build your faith, you must read your Bible. You must study your Word. You must read it. And you must listen to sermons. Listen to very well, you know, taught sermons. And not only is that a building block, but also prayer. Prayer is a building block for your faith. Because if you start praying to God and He starts answering you, what happens? Your faith is grown. It's stronger, isn't it? And it grows more. And not only that, but there's obedience. I know you can't see it, but you will see it soon. So faith is the foundation. Faith is the building block on which you build. He says it there. Add to faith what? Virtue. Virtue is the next block you're putting on top. This means moral excellence. You do what is right. A child of God must do what is right. I find some people and they've got excuses for doing what's wrong. I don't want to hear your excuses. You must do what's right. This is what he says. If you've got faith, the first thing you put on that is you pray to God and you say, Lord, help me to do what is right. If you've got faith and you keep on doing what's wrong, you're not going to build. You're not going to grow into the fullness of Christ. And again, there's some building blocks there for you if you want. We need that God. We know that God's got standards, do we? I'm not going to go through all the verses. I've put them in there and I can email it to you, but this is beautiful. But God has got standards of right and wrong. If God says telling a lie is wrong, what do? You tell the truth. If God says stealing something is wrong, what do? You don't steal. If God says He doesn't like gossiping, what do? You stop gossiping. Can we go on? You get the point here. But we must live moral lives. We must strive to moral excellence. And be careful. Don't compare your excellence with somebody next to you. Because that is pride and boastfulness. You just concentrate on what you build. So the first one is faith. And you're built on top of faith. Virtue, he says. And then he says knowledge. Look at this. Knowledge means to seek understanding, to seek and to understand God. And by the way, the word here for knowledge is the word gnosis. It's not epinosis. It's gnosis. So what is that gnosis? It is studying the Word. It's reading the Word. So we need to continue to read and to study the Word. That we do that by studying the Word and we seek wisdom from God. And what do you build upon that? Let's have a look. He says knowledge, and then to knowledge we build self-control. What is self-control? You know, it is governing impulses and desires. How are you going with your impulses? But see where it all starts, with faith, and with virtue, and with knowledge. Listen, if you miss one of these blocks, then this falls apart. You can't have self-control if you haven't got the knowledge of what God has put into place. And you can't have that if you understand God's standards. You see, this is why we've got churches with weak Christians because they've never been taught. They brought to the point of being born again. And we keep on preaching to them, you must be born again. And they are already born again. And we keep on telling them how bad they are. And we keep on telling them how God's going to punish them. Instead of starting to train them. Instead of starting to show them that you need to work on your salvation. Are you with me now? You get the trend. If you go through this, you will become a Christ-like follower. And you will be strong in your faith. You know, the building blocks for self-control is look at the triggers in your life. What is triggering you to do what you do? Oh, no, no, you know what's my trigger in the fridge. Black Forest cake. Yeah? That's a trigger. I know if I buy the cake and I put it in the fridge, I haven't got there. Self-control. And now I've learned knowledge. If I don't put it in the fridge, I ain't going to eat it until I put it in the fridge. So I need to go into that. And then we ask the Holy Spirit to help us. And fasting is a very good thing. I put words down here which just came to me last night. Fasting is a very good one of these. If you ever want to test your self-control, take a day or two and say, Lord, I want to fast totally, just water. Just try that, okay? Because that will teach you and show you where you are sitting with your self-control. Let me hurry on. Because he says to self-control, what do we put on? Perseverance. What is perseverance? It is steadfastness, doing something. The building blocks for this is enduring. James chapter 1 verse 4. Set goals for yourself and trust on God's faithfulness. After that comes godliness. This is the awareness of God's sovereignty within your lifestyle. This you gain with more worship. Start worshiping God, and the godliness with God will start flowing through you, and you pursue holiness. And then it comes to brotherly kindness. This means to care for others. I'm just hurrying up now, okay? You know I'm talking fast. He says there, serve, encourage, build community, and be active. I love this church because we're a church operating church, aren't we? The church is working, isn't it? I love it. And here is the fantastic thing. Nobody asks you to do it. Except my wife when she sometimes say, hey, are you on the kitchen duty? But you are doing it out of free will. That is it. This is where you're building up. Now, let me put the last one in and then I will bring it all home. Love sits at the top, isn't it right? Love is the highest virtue and characteristic by selflessness, sacrificial care for others. We practice love and forgiveness. Now, brothers and sisters, this is the fullness of Christ. This is the fullness. Now, it's not as if you come to the top and you tick it and you say, I've got my license now. No, no, you grow through these phases. This is what he says, add, multiply to these things. You grow through these phases. If somebody comes to you, what will they first see? They see love. You know, that's the first thing that I look for people. Where is the love? Where is God's love? Somebody do something to you and you will not forgive them, the love goes. Then you need to dig deeper in. Where is the brotherly kindness? Oh, there's no brotherly kindness. But wait a minute, you call yourself a child of God. And then you go and you look for godliness. There's no godliness in these people. And then you go further and, oh, there's no perseverance. Every small little thing throw them off and they want to turn away and walk away from God. You look at self-control and you look at their lives and there's absolutely no self-control. They give themselves into substances and everything. And you go deeper and you say it's because they don't study their Bible. They don't know God. They just want to continue on. And you go deeper and you say there's no virtue, they've got no morals in their life, there's no standard for them. And then you go down to faith and you say, was there faith ever from the start? How beautiful is God's word? Everything flows. And by the way, you can't say, oh, I can do all of these things, but that's self-control. If you take self-control out, the house falls down. But again, you can't jump from faith right into self-control if you haven't gone through all of these steps. Can you see? This is, man, I can stand here and preach the whole day just on those blocks, isn't it? Eh, Sean? All of them fits together. And this is how God fits together. And can you see now? Peter comes to them, he says, I'm going to talk to you about false teachers. But before you point the finger, make sure your house is in order. May I ask you this morning, is your house in order? Where are you sitting here? Which is one of these that you've identified and said, Lord, I need to work more on that. If you say to me this morning, Pastor, you know, I've looked at brotherly kindness, but I just haven't got the care for others. I'm only looking at myself. I'm only the one who grabs everything for myself. I'm the one who just looks, you know, I'm that last person. If the wife brings out the chicken and everybody likes the chicken legs, you know, whatever you eat them, and there's only two, I take two for me and they get the rest. Well, if you say that is that, then I'm going to dig deeper in and say, maybe the problem lies down each and one of these. And here is the last thing I say on that. He says, for he who lacks these things. Wow. This is an indictment now, isn't it? What does the word lack mean? He who hasn't got them. He who hasn't got enough of them. He who lacks all of these things, what happens is, would you like me if I walk up to you and say to you in your face, you are short-sighted? But maybe we should. What will happen with you if I take you, and I'm not strong anymore, I can't do it, I know my shoulder is sore, but take you by your legs, turn you upside down and shake you. What happens if I rattle your cage? What's coming out? And he says here, he says, if you lack these things, you are short-sighted, even to blindness, and has forgotten that you were cleansed from your old sins. Why? Because you trail in one of those things. Praise the Lord. I pray the Lord has blessed you. If he hasn't blessed you with those two nuggets in the beginning, he certainly blessed me. So you just had to witness. That's all. Did we learn something today? May the Lord bless you. Father, we thank you this morning for your holy kindness. And Father, we thank you for your word. And Father, I pray, Lord, that we grow in your word and in faith. Father, we want to grow. We want to come into the fullness of Christ. Father, not to walk around and to put a badge on ourselves and say, look, I've achieved. We've achieved nothing, Lord. Father, because once I go to one point and I reach self-control sometimes, then something happens and I realize I need to work more on it. Help us all.